They get so narrow at the bottom.
So, remember what I said in my last update video? We might be doing some movies here and there. Just a ton of stuff that is gonna be really good for my channel. Yeah, I wasn't kidding. If you have not seen my last update video, I'd highly recommend you check it out to see where I plan to take this channel. But to make a long story short, I want to make this channel more of a place where I can talk about things that I couldn't normally talk about with my older style of videos, like video games and movies and such. And, well, here we are. I swear, we're still gonna do video games, it's not gonna go away, but right now we're doing this. So before we get into the movie itself, let's start with a little bit of context. This film was directed by Howard E. Baker and Erich Fizee. I'm sorry if I mispronounced your name. Released in 2008, this film is a part of a direct-to-DVD film trilogy that was made by Unstable Fables and distributed by the Jim Henson Company. As apparently it's easy for these guys to put the name of somebody who is full of creativity and talent to a product with no talent or creativity whatsoever.
You know, it's amazing. You are 100% wrong. I mean, nothing you've said has been right.
These films were also distributed by the Weinstein Company, same people who distributed Leo the Lion. You know, this.
I'm a vegetarian. I'm a vegetarian.
But unlike that movie where it had an original plot, these movies were primarily based on fairy tales with a twist added to their traditional plots. Think Shrek, just with none of the great budget or storytelling. Yeah, pretty much. Now, the reason I wanted to review this movie in particular is because, well, I've already watched this movie more times than necessary. It's one of those movies from your childhood where you watch it as a kid, and then you look back on it years later and realize it was never really good in the first place. You see, kids, that's what we call maturing. With a confused plot, juvenile spastic animation, and, well, this. We'll get to you soon! How does this film hold up all these years later? Well, I guess I gotta start somewhere where you're reviewing movies for your YouTube channel. This is Three Pigs and a Baby. So how long do you guys think it's gonna be until we see some nightmare fuel in the very first frame? Seriously, what the hell am I looking at here? Are they supposed to be weasel possum hybrids or something? Are they supposed to be the mascots of the company? If so, what relevance do they have in relation to the company? At least with Scrat and Minions it made sense because those characters were in the first projects of those companies and they have some sort of background. Here, these characters just do some shit and you never hear from them again. You might be thinking, it's the opening logo, who cares? But they drag on this logo for about 40 seconds with highly choreographed animation just to introduce their logo. That doesn't usually happen with logos unless if the character has some sort of importance. It also doesn't help that these logos and credits are introduced in such a confusing fashion. First it's the Weinstein logo, then the opening credits, sandwiched with this overly long logo, and then the title of the movie with no transition from the previous logos. Why did they make these logos so confusing to follow? We're not even in the actual movie and there's already a list full of problems. Okay, so the real film starts with the main characters getting ready to be murdered!
Yep, that's me. You're probably wondering how I ended up in this situation.
That may sound bad, but trust me, by the end of this movie, you'd wish they were dead. The pigs then retell the entire movie through a flashback, a trope that I totally haven't seen done a billion times already. We then see the story of the three little pigs, but with a twist. The evil wolf gang has a whole operation behind their seemingly simple plot, a trope that I definitely haven't seen done a billion times already. We then meet our incredibly dim-witted and stoned stereotype, Sandy, who looks like a cross between Young Gravy and Orson from Garfield. He gets his house blown down and runs to his brother's house with the wolf chasing after him.
Bro, it's a wolf!
Oh my god, just look at this animation! It's like if the model is having a glitchy meltdown. Looks like the movie is about to crash! We then meet our constantly worried and organized about everything stereotype, Richard, who I'm pretty sure has all his aneurysms bottled after Howie Mandel. He gets his house blown down, which leads to the two of them going to their last brother's house.
It's Richard and Sandy! Your brother!
Can you please back away from the camera? Feels like I'm in the goddamn Twilight Zone. I know I grazed over it before, but this animation is just awful. Like, truly some of the worst I've ever seen in a film. These characters either move too quickly in the wrong ways or too slowly in the wrong ways, and it never looks appealing. Sometimes the models don't even know what to do with themselves, so it just ends up looking like a bunch of glitchy animated white noise. Not to mention the hideous character designs that all look like they were sleep paralysis demons illustrated by John Christopher Lucy.
One of them's a hot chick. With big cans. And nice legs. Who drew that? You?
She's underage, too.
Yeah, very nice. Hey now.
They're let inside the brick house where we're introduced to our crotchety, bad-tempered stereotype, Mason.
Stonemason!
Who I feel is definitely the ugliest out of the three. Which is saying a lot, considering the wolves look like they should have had their noses censored in post. Surprisingly enough, the house is unable to be blown down, so the wolf goes through the chimney. But the pigs quickly set a fire in their mantle. But not without a bunch of pointless filler added in.
You call that a stick? How am I supposed to start a fire with a log?
I think I know my way around sticks.
Dude, you should really bank the sticks, like teepee style, against the back. And if it was me, I'd use straw. But, you know, your fire.
Be quiet!
The wolf then jumps down the chimney where he meets his untimely demise. The wolves are then left defeated. They probably would have been more successful if they had dressed them up as a Jewish salesman. As the pigs reconcile about their victory against the wolves, the two brothers move in with Mason, and they all live happily ever after. Yeah, I wish. So Bruno Mars' persona enters the scene as he gets into the wolf's secret lair.
Password, wolf power, dog.
Oh yeah, and he sounds like Snoop Dogg. The wolves then have a meeting discussing how they plan to get revenge on the pigs, as they introduce us to even more stereotypes, including a musical Broadway wolf whose one character trait is to make everything into a musical, and a pacifist wolf whose one character trait is that he doesn't want to hurt the pigs. Then why did he join this group if he didn't want to kill the pigs? I don't know. We're then introduced to the evil scientist wolf who claims he has a plan to get revenge on the pigs. He's played by Tom Kenny. That's right, the voice of SpongeBob.
You will see sights so heinous, so terrible, so utterly unpleasant, your eyeballs will tremble just wondering what it is.
Oh yeah, there's also this running joke where the wolf has this tail where it has a mind of its own. You see, I call it a joke, but like, it's not funny at all. So, I guess it's just a random thing that happens. You'll find a lot of scenes like that in this movie. Just a bunch of pointless shit added to pad out the runtime.
Here, I'm Big Boss Wolf, I'm in charge. You're the minions, and you're the audience.
Dr. Wolfenstein then reveals his plan to the other wolves. And I'm not kidding you, this plan is gonna blow your goddamn mind.
Team of wolves approaches the target house with what we call the package. They ring the doorbell and leave the package on the front step. The pigs open the door to see what it is and discover that it's a baby, which they find adorable and take inside and raise as their own. When the package is sufficiently grown up, it leaves the key to the house under the doormat, and then we let ourselves in. Won't get those pigs. Then revenge will be ours. Sweet revenge. Sweet like.
Wait. Time out. Is this real? Was this written by a team of people? Is this written by professional people? So let me get this straight. Your idea is to deliver a random ass baby to the pig's house. Hope the pigs will take it inside and raise it in their home, wait literal years for the baby to be fully developed, and then hope the fully grown baby will conveniently leave the key under the mat so you guys can break inside the house and kill the pigs. Oh my god, what kind of stupid bullshit contrived force plot device is that? First of all, where the hell are you guys even gonna get a baby from? Is there like a breeding wolf locked up in your basement somewhere whose only purpose is to be there just in case you guys ever need a bunch of babies? Because that would have been a way better movie in my opinion. Second, you have to wait years for this plan to finally go into action. In the time it takes for this baby to fully grow up, you could have easily found a better and faster way of killing the pigs. Why not use that doomsday device you alluded to before? Oh yeah, did I not mention that? The science wolf has this doomsday device that he's apparently been working on for years, but the chief wolf says that they need a more practical way of killing the pigs. This is not more practical, this would just take so much longer! Lastly, what if the pigs don't even end up taking care of the baby? Or even if they do, what happens if something happens to the kid that prevents him from staying at the pig's house? Like if they kick him out or they send him to a new home when he's old enough? You can't guarantee he'll still be at the house this whole time! Did the people who write this script even proofread it before they put it out? This has to be the dumbest plot device I have ever seen in a movie. Ugh. God, let's just move on. Okay, so after that scene, we get to see the pigs working on their houses getting rebuilt. Which leads to, you guessed it, more padding.
Sorry we're late. Our other client is a total pig.
That's racist.
Yeah, nothing personal.
It's still racist.
The two then ask Mason if they can stay at his house for one more night.
G Miami.
Oh, I'll never get rid of these guys.
Damn. Mason's kind of an asshole. I mean, I get wanting to be alone, but your brothers were almost murdered and they had their houses destroyed. Mind showing them a little bit of sympathy? The wolves then finally put their plan into action.
In the longest, most drawn-out way possible.
Roger that.
Delivering package to target. Deliver package to target. Porch it! Put it on the porch! Activate greeting klaxon.
They could have just snuck around, put the baby on the doorstep, ring the doorbell, and then leave. But no, we gotta have all of this padding. So the wolves finally end up delivering the baby as the pigs come outside, too stupid to realize that they have two cock noses staring right back at them. They take the baby inside, and Mason decides he's gonna call the authorities to take the baby away. You know, like a normal person would. But after minimal convincing...
And you could read the Wallstein journal to him!
I always wanted an heir.
The pigs decide to raise the baby and name him Lucky. They then go through all the baby-raising cliches, such as feeding the baby food that can kill him, changing the baby's diaper, and having the baby piss into their mouths.
Come on, even the son of the mass didn't have the baby piss in the dad's mouth. They did something worse, but they still avoided the mouth!
It then cuts to this montage of the pigs raising the baby over the years, and they were so lazy that they couldn't even be bothered to animate half of it, instead going for this scrapbook aesthetic, including the most wonderful artwork. Oh yeah, more house stuff.
We're on a lunch break.
Again?
Cows have four stomachs?
Another scrapbook scene later, and we cut to the pigs dropping off Lucky at his first day of school.
Why is the camera moving so much? Stop moving the camera! Stop moving the camera!
Congratulations, animators, you have somehow made your audience seasick within 10 seconds. Oh god, he looks like Lewis if you got shot out of Porky's asshole!
What the heck are you?
Oh god, they look like Alvin and Buford just got shot out of Porky's asshole.
Porky, I'm so sorry.
As a pig, I am very dirty and should not be touched by humans.
Wait a minute, I've heard that laugh before. Either it's all a coincidence, or they literally stole that sound from one of these ads. Well, considering how this movie likes to cut corners anyway, I wouldn't put it past them. One shitty scrapbook later, and we get to see Lucky in his teen years, who ends up looking like Logic just got cross-contaminated with Rocket from Guardians of the Galaxy. He's your average punk teenager cliche, he's rude, passive-aggressive, and even wants a motorcycle. All he's missing is a leather jacket.
Yeah, it's a little small and a lot lame.
Stop shopping for me.
Oh, well, never mind, I guess.
In the meantime, the pigs are still in the process of getting their houses built. Okay, if it really takes you this long to rebuild a house that should have at the very most taken you a couple of months to rebuild, you might as well just move in with your brother at that point.
I mean, we've been sitting waiting for this package for what? Years?
I know. The package might never be ready.
Oh, so I guess someone did take a look at that stupidly written plot device. And they put it in the movie anyway. Why? Because they thought nobody would notice this astronomically sized plot hole. That is how little they cared.
Props to you, movie, for acknowledging your incompetence when it comes to story writing.
This is then immediately followed by a scene that really makes me question the intelligence of these pigs. You know, I really don't think this whole plan was necessary for grabbing the pigs. I mean, if the quote smartest of the three can't tell when a wolf is literally staring right back at him, I really think they could have gone through with this a lot easier. By the way, Lucky's supposed to be, what, 16? You're telling me nobody looked in that mailbox for 16 years? Look at this, he's literally avoiding eye contact with the mailbox. He knows he's in there full damn well. There are so many plot holes in this movie, it makes Swiss cheese look American. Lucky is then seen causing problems back at home with his artificial rebellion, where he's causing concern for his dad's.
You know what?
Oh, man.
Sometimes...
Yeah, my mom.
I mean, like...
What you said.
Totally.
Yeah.
Okay, I think Lucky has finally discovered Sandy's crack pipe.
Lucky and his parents then get into a big fight, where they reveal that Lucky is adopted. Lucky then storms out the front of the house, only to appear from the left side of the screen right after. Like, seriously, did they even watch this animation back? He ends up in Darkwood, god, they're not even trying anymore, where he comes across Snoop Dogg, Snoop Wolf, just forget it. Cool Wolf ends up taking him to the wolf's secret lair, where he's met by the chief and his minions to try to convince him that he is indeed a wolf. They also try to convince him by...
Don't you feel different and left out? Do you ever get these weird feelings?
Yes, feelings. Like stuff. It just builds up and...
Yeah, it totally builds up. Why do you go to Pigville Academy?
Because I'm a pig?
Maybe, Lucky. Maybe. Maybe you're a wolf.
A wolf?
By sexually assaulting him? Now, I don't know the exact ages of these two, but if she was a teenager when he was a baby, does that mean... Okay. How can we move past this scene? Oh, right. Of course. A song. A song out of nowhere. Yeah. Yeah, because that'll totally get my mind off of a child wolf being groomed to death while he gets a wolf erection. You cannot have these two scenes play back to back.
Oh, and surprise, surprise, the song is fucking awful. What did you expect?
I'm
a goofy goober!
The wolves then tell Lucky he needs to get the key under the mat so they can get to the pigs on the full moon. Lucky is unaware about why they want to get the pigs, even though in the song, he said this.
I see what you mean. It's more than a hunch.
You like pork?
I could eat it every day for lunch.
And even before that, the chief showed them what they plan to do with the pigs in this little slideshow, so this just leaves Lucky looking like a dumbass either way.
Here's a mix CD I made. Some righteous wolf tunes. You'll dig it.
Let me know when you want to hear the next episode.
Lucky comes home, avoids a punishment from his dads, and goes to school the next day to stand up to his bullies, which gets him the attention of the girl pig that bears a striking resemblance to Chrissy from MasterChef. Meanwhile, the wolves are training for the night on the full moon to go and attack the pigs. Which makes me question, what the hell were you guys doing the whole time he was growing up?
Why am I even asking this question? I'm obviously not gonna get an answer.
I'm gonna pop and huff.
Oh,
and
Grandma, what a small brain you have. No, not puff and huff. It's huff and pop.
What is your major malfunction, numbnuts?
Back at home, Richard tries to confront Lucky about his behavior.
Lucky, you can talk to me anytime and tell me anything. I will not listen. I'll just judge you. No, wait, that's wrong. That's wrong. The other way around.
Okay, I have to give credit where credit is due.
It's Harry, man. It's very hairy.
God.
Eat the pigs.
Huh, my son's listening to music that suggests slaughtering my species. No, it's probably nothing.
Though, to be fair, he could be listening to this.
Here I go, lyrical. I have no idea what I'm doing, but I'm spiritual. On the microphone, I tear you up in stereo.
The next day, Lucky and his friend bump into the cool wolf and the get the hell away from that kid, you crazy bitch, before I call the cops wolf. They remind Lucky about his mission.
The key of the mat, do you remember?
Yeah, the key. So, why am I putting the key on?
Okay, you know, I really try to give these people the benefit of the doubt here, but I just can't take it anymore. How stupid were the people who wrote this script? He literally chants a song with the lyrics, eat the pigs. Not to mention all the other anti-pig propaganda he's already participating in. You cannot have this many plot holes in your movie. It's one thing to have a couple of plot holes in a good movie. But when your movie is made up of nothing but plot holes, that's a problem! I don't care if you didn't have enough time to fix everything, I don't care if it's just for kids, you are not allowed to have a movie this broken!
More I think about it, the more I'm gonna get pissed off, so let's just move on!
The wolves then tell Lucky they're going to throw a party at his dad's place, which Lucky believes because he has the cognitive ability of a 4-year-old. Later that night, he places the key under the mat with the wolves heading towards the brick house, as they try to tell, jokes.
You're not funny!
They are so desperate for a laugh that they literally have the wolves grab teacups for literally no reason at all.
Random nonsense in your movie does not equal comedy. What was even the point of that? What, did they animate the first part of the joke but forgot to add the punchline?
But then, Lucky finally realizes the wolves' true intentions, yeah, it took you long enough, through a Vietnam-style flashback. Lucky returns back home where the wolves are destroying the pigs' houses. Again.
Dude, that truly is the last straw.
After blowing the first two houses down, the wolves unlock the door to the brick house where the film returns to the beginning of the movie. Why didn't the wolves just kill the pigs through that entire monologue? I really have no idea, but Lucky crashes through the window, saves his dads, and rides off to the brick house.
Gentlemen! It is time for the Doomsday Device!
The Doomsday Device?
Oh yeah, the Doomsday Device! You know, that device you could have used instead of using this overly complicated clusterfuck of a plan!
So the wolves finally unveil their Doomsday Device, which ends up being a giant fan. Why not a wrecking ball, or something that'll actually knock down the bricks? You guys have weights! The wolves then get to the brick house and use their giant fan, Doomsday Device. But before the house can be blown down, Lucky steps in front of the house and nearly sacrifices himself for his dads, which leads the Chief Wolf to divert from the mission.
Wolfhelm Scream!
This ends up giving the Chief Wolf a change of heart, because apparently this was the easiest way of ending this movie. This then leads to a cinematic battle between Doofenshmirtz Wolf and Arm E. Ermy Wolf.
Now, Tailey, now!
Oh look, they finally give the tail some sort of purpose in the movie. It doesn't really do much of anything, but hey, it justifies all this filler, right? No, it doesn't. You cannot just have a pointless side gag that only exists to pad out the runtime be justifiable after it bitch slaps someone. Hey, from Awana had a more important role than you. The science wolf then meets his defeat after getting blown away from his fan.
You won't get away with this!
Call off the pack. Lucky got lucky here tonight. Maybe we all did.
The Chief Wolf then lets Lucky stay with his adopted family, to which Lucky responds by letting the Chief Wolf being a part of their family, because attempt at murder is always justifiable at the end. The film ends with the Science Wolf being left stranded on an island. Now, I would say this ending was ripping off Sponge out of water, but I'd be lying. SpongeBob is the true thief here. How ironic.
A tiny desert island that I shall rule!
And that was Three Pigs and a Baby. What are my final thoughts? I think you'd be better off watching this.
And I'm working my way through college.
And you?
No, I got you!
From frame one to the final line, this film was broken. At only an hour and 16 minutes, it somehow manages to have a confused story with far too many plot holes being present, a lost narrative that doesn't know the right way to present itself, and has a bunch of characters that are all forgettable and don't leave an impact throughout the story. But here are some of the major things that really stood out to me as a viewer. Firstly, the movie spends way too much time on pointless details, not enough time on the important ones, and has an astronomical amount of plot holes, which is actually kind of impressive for a film of this caliber. The story can't decide what it wants to be, hopping from one plot point to the next in a very discombobulated fashion, with the pacing not really helping in this regard either. The script is also written where characters have very conflicting personality traits throughout the film, like Mason not noticing the wolves despite him being shown as the most logical out of the three, and once again that out of nowhere character shift from the Chief at the very end. The writing ends up giving a very poor direction of where it comes to these characters' motivations and traits. Lastly, the animation quality and style are both very unpleasant from the beginning to the very end. Once again, these characters all either move too sluggishly or too rapidly, and their designs all look like ugly barnyard character rejects.
I got the sweet leg!
We got it, thanks.
So overall, this film can best be summed up as an uninteresting, bland, highly problematic movie with zero focus whatsoever. It's cliche at best, forgettable at worst, and if anything, should be viewed as nothing more than a pigsty.
Well guys, there was my first movie review. I know it was a little different from when I usually post, but I want to make this channel more of a place where I can talk about the things I really want to talk about. There's going to be room for video games, there's going to be room for movies, so let me know what you guys think about that, and with all that being said, I'm Jace Perez. Keep drawing and drawing and drawing, and you'll get there. I'll see you next time.
It's hairy, man. It's very hairy.